Hey, 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 everybody, come on in. Oh, I don't own the rights to this music. This is The Best Days of Your Life, the Potter's House of Denver, Colorado. Miss Virginia, God bless you. I see you. Y'all, come on in. Hey there, Pastor Marks. God bless you, sir. Hey, Darlene. Brother Tyrone, bless you, man. Sister Arnetta, dear. How are you? Hey, hey, hey. Hey, Sister Hattie. March. Auntie. It's Yvette. How you doing? Oh, Lord. What is that? Go on, girl. Hey there, preacher. Elder Tory. Woo! Hot. Bless you, sir. Woo! Y'all come on in. Got about a minute. I pray you all are doing absolutely wonderful today. Pray you had a good day today. If you didn't, I did. Oh, but it's getting ready to get good right now. Hey, hey. Brother Leonard Taylor. Bless you, Brother Tyrone. Hey, Brother Gary. All right, all right. Hey, Carmella. Yo. Hey, Johnny Taylor. All right. Listen, I ask you all to please share this page. You got about 30 seconds to go. I'm ready for the word tonight. Let's get it tonight. Y'all ready? Let's invite our family and friends in to be a part of tonight's conversation. Lady Sergeant, Aunt Hattie says hello. She says, hello, Aunt Hattie. Sister Lillian, I see you. I like that move. Gotta go. Time to go to church. Mr. Karen, God bless you. Brother Tommy, hey family, as we always say, this is the day the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. God bless you all. Listen, thank you all for being here. Man, listen, I am so excited. I'm pumped. I'm stoked. I am so glad to be here, man. Listen, the word tonight is going to be good. As always, I encourage you to get your pencils out, your pad out, whatever it is you write on, and let's get ready to dive in and take some good notes, because I believe tonight God wants to speak to us. And I believe that tonight the word of God is going to be good. It's going to be rich, praise God. Listen, have you all been blessed over these last 9 weeks? Come on, let me know. Have y'all been blessed by the word over these last 9 weeks? Man, that's a lot of preaching, y'all. Glory to God. Hey, Deacon Price. This is Bobby Jean Robinson. I see you all. Man, that's a lot of preaching. But listen, y'all, if you all haven't been blessed, man, I bless myself. Glory to God. I've been inspired by the word. I mean, I have been enjoying myself these last few, these last 9 weeks. I have really, really, really been enjoying the word of God tonight, and I pray. I mean, I'm over these last 9 weeks, and as always, it is my prayer that you all have been blessed by the word. Listen, let's pray and let's dive into the word tonight. Come on, Father of Heaven, thank you again for this chance to share your word tonight. Thank you, precious God, for getting us up to this time. Now, Father, as always, it is our sincere prayer that you would speak through our mouth, think through our mind. Father, none of me and all of you are tonight be glorified as you always are. We bless you and I give your name maximum glory. In Jesus' name, I do pray. Amen, amen, and amen. All right, come on, class. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, which is our foundational text for this week. Hebrews chapter number 11. I want to look at verse 1. Hebrews chapter 11. Look at verse 1. Again, God bless all of y'all for being a part of tonight's conversation, tonight's Bible class online. Glad that you all are a part tonight. I pray again that something is said that will bless you and enrich your life for the better. All right, Hebrews 11, verse 1 says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." All right, tonight I'm excited you all about getting back into our series, because I believe once we get our faith in order, we are going to transform, watch this, have our lives transform and also transform the lives of others. You're saying, "Pastor, how is that possible?" When I look at the disciples, they spent 3.5 years with Jesus, and he taught them the kingdom of heaven and the principles of faith. He taught for 3.5 years, he taught them that. And once they were filled with the Holy Spirit, they left Jerusalem. And the Bible said that 12 men turned the world upside down. And this is what I want from all of you, all of us, and myself included, is that, listen, when this, what they call pandemic, is over with, man, listen, I want us to turn this world upside down for the kingdom of God, right? Turn our houses upside down, our communities upside down. I want the glory of God to be ever present as we do it, exercise our faith and listen, and give God maximum glory all across in everything that we do. Y'all, give me 1 second. Leader Kerr, can you please find out if they cut my grass right now? Please. Hope it's not them, but it could be them. I'm not sure. I'm sorry, you all. Please forgive me. I have to think about having my grass cut the wrong way. And I think they're outside cutting my grass right now. And I'm growing new grass in the back. And I don't want them cutting my grass in the back. Praise the Lord. So y'all forgive me. All right. But tonight I'm excited, because here's what I want. I want us to make sure that when this is done, our faith is strong. Our faith is built. That our faith is where it should be for what's ahead of us. Right. And so we entitled this lesson, Building Your Faith Week. Okay, that's fine. Excuse me. Please tell them to be careful back in the back where my new grass is. Thank you. Tell them don't roll in my new grass. Don't do the new grass. No. Well, it's still dirt over there. Tell them, please don't roll in that. Y'all, please forgive Pastor. And take care of some home stuff. So forgive me. All right. Generally, I wouldn't do that. But I'm growing new grass in the back. All right. And so y'all, please forgive Pastor for that. You get it? Okay, well, tell the guy, because one guy's in the back, I'm sure. Tiana, handle that. You a gangster. Over that. Oh, and so last night, I'm everywhere right now. And so last night, I left off by letting you know that our God, you all, is an infinite God. Okay, and because he's an infinite God, we understand that we can trust him. And this is important, because he knows everything. He is everywhere at the same time. We said last night, he was immeasurable. He is endless. He is unlimited. And he has no boundaries. And that's the greatest thing, you all, about our God. And I need you to catch this, because sometimes we look at life, and what life does is make us believe that our God has limitations. That's right. I'm growing my grass. That's right. I got a nice backyard. I'll put it on Facebook as soon as it's finished. So that's right. I play golf in the backyard. And so one of the things I need us to know, that God, our God, is immeasurable, and our God has no limitations. And this is what we need to know, because the Bible said, God said, Jesus says, he's sending us out as sheep among wolves. And because we're sheep among wolves, what the devil wants to do is intimidate you. Hear me. The devil wants to intimidate you and I, and make us believe that the God we serve has limitations and boundaries. And so we must understand that our God has no limitations. He is immeasurable, he is endless, and he is unlimited. And once we understand that, hear me, once you and I understand that, then we understand that because we serve this type of God and because we are his children. Listen, the apple should not fall far from a tree, glory to God. And so since we are his children, we are called, according to St. John 1:12, we shall be called the sons of God. He said, as many as believe on his name. And so since you and I believe on his name, we are his sons and his daughters, right? And since we are that, we understand then that everything that is in God is in us. Even Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branch. And you know, if you understand agriculture, everything that's in the vine is in the branch as well. And so because of that, we understand that everything that that God is, then you and I have the capacity to operate in this earth like God. And so the question is then, how do we see what we don't physically possess? All right, that's what we left off last night. How then do we see what we don't physically possess and still be convinced that we have it? Because this is what faith is about. We have to be convinced that we have that which we don't physically possess or that is not tangible in our hands. It is up to us to believe with all of our heart and all of our might that we possess it. All right. And so this is where I left off last night. And so I'll pick up right here. Understand, this is done, watch this now, through biblical meditation. Okay. This is done through biblical meditation. All right. And so this is our subtitle for tonight, biblical meditation. Pastor, make that make sense. Okay, let me give you my definition for biblical meditation. You got to catch this, okay? I'm going to say it slow. Catch on. Okay, biblical meditation, watch this now, is the prayerful reflection on God, on the Word of God, where we ask the Holy Spirit to illuminate our understanding in order to help us see His intended purpose. I'll say it again. It is the prayerful reflection on the Word of God, where we ask Holy Spirit to illuminate our understanding in order to help us see God's intended purpose. I'll say it again so you can get this down. All right. It is the prayerful reflection on the Word of God. Hear me now. It's the prayerful reflection on the Word of God. All right, where we ask the Holy Spirit to illuminate our understanding in order to help us see God's intended purpose. Let me make that make sense for you. When you and I are praying, we pray, this is why I always encourage you to pray according to the will of God. You can't pray according to the will of God if you don't know the Word of God. And so when we pray the Word of God, we are praying the will of God. And then we pray and ask Holy Spirit, who is our comforter. He's the paracletus. He's our helper. He comes alongside to help us, right? He helps us, and we ask him to illuminate, to cut the light on. In other words, give us the revelation of what the Word is saying. Because there is one thing to get surface on what God is saying and something else to get a revelation. Because now, once we have a revelation of what God is saying, hear me now, once we have revelation of what God is saying in his Word, the devil cannot steal what you know in your heart. Because now the light has come on. See, he can steal what is in your head, right? But the Bible says, he cannot take from you what's in your heart. This is why when the Word of God is sown, he comes right away to take away the word that is sown in your heart. Why? Because he wants to catch it while it's still in your head and before it gets in your heart. Pastor, why is that? Because if he can catch that word before it gets into your heart, he understands that any word that gets into your heart, and once you know this word, once you can catch this word, the enemy of our faith understands that if we ever catch this word and it gets in our heart. Hear me. Listen, not only will it grow, it'll grow and help us. It'll also grow, and then we can then in turn help those around us, right? But first, it must get into our hearts. And the enemy wants to do all he can to make sure that word never gets into our heart and incubates instead of root, and then begin to sprout and grow up into our hearts. And so we pray the word of God, and we allow the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, to help our understanding. The Bible says that all thy getting, hear me, it says get understanding. So the question is, Pastor Larry, what then do we want to understand? Because the more I understand about God, watch this now, the more I understand, the more I'm able to see God's intended purpose. Come on. The more I understand, the more I can see God's intended purpose. It's like I understand why God says give. Okay? He says give so I can, he said it's more blessed to give than to receive. Why? Because God knows that if I give with a cheerful heart of expectation, listen, I can also expect reciprocity on my gift because God understands that. And so God says, if you do this, then I will do this, right? And so God understands that. And so when I pray the word of God, get into God's word, and then now I get to see what God's intended purpose is for our lives. Now, hear me, there are some things you will not understand, okay? There are some things we must just trust God to do what he says he'll do, even though we don't see anything, right? Our job is to trust what God says. And listen, as the old folks say, take God at his word, praise the Lord. And that's what you and I must do. Learn to take God at his word. Because when we do, hear me, when we take God at his word, it is a sign of our faith, our trust, and our confidence in him. Now, question, have you noticed the number of commercials that you and I have been flooded with? Come on. Have you noticed all the commercials that we see every day? I mean, dear God, we know, watch this. I'm going to start, you finish it. Hold the pickles, hold the lettuce. Uh-huh. What commercial is that? Come on, we know all the commercials. We know all the commercials. Listen, we have heard them so much until we know them by heart. Now, watch this. What those commercials are designed to do is to help us see ourselves getting what they're advertising. And they understand that if we hear it enough, hear me, they understand that if we hear it enough, it will create an appetite for us to go get it. In other words, watch this. Have you ever gone to the store and you bought something you really didn't need, but you bought because you saw it on television? Come on, I know it's not just this preacher. Come on. Have you ever gone to the store? You bought something because you saw it on TV. Come on. You didn't need it, really didn't want it, but because you saw it on television, you bought it. And then you got home and said, I ain't need this. I'll tell you why you did it. You saw it on television. And watch this. Television is where the person on television gets to tell you their vision, right? And if you hear their vision long enough, their vision becomes your vision, and you will find yourself having an appetite to have it, come on, to the point where you just really have to have it and you know you don't need it. Come on, because you get home and you have what's often called buyer's remorse. Come on, because you bought something you really didn't need. And so this is what God intends for us to do with the word of God. When it comes to biblical meditation, listen, as you and I begin to meditate in the word of God, it will create an appetite for us to, watch this, desire those things that God wants us to desire. Hear me, class. When we do biblical meditation, we are creating a desire for the things that God really wants us to possess. See, the Bible said that God will give us the desires of our heart. Well, listen, the desires of our heart really comes from the word of God. Because, hear me, watch this. When God gives you and I a desire that comes through his word, when we see in the word of God where something hits our spirit and God says, begin to ask me for that. When we begin to ask God for that, watch this, the reason God can do it is because we're asking for something that was already his design to give us. Hear me, class. It was already God's desire to give it to us. And so when we see God's word, the light comes on. The light comes on. The light comes on. Understanding takes place. And now I understand why God wants us to have it. Right? And so that's why we study God's word. Because listen, God wants you to have the best. He wants you to live in the best. Come on. God wants you, watch this. God wants you living on the top. Glory to God. Come on. God declared, he said, you are the head and not the tail. But you can't live, listen, you cannot be a top feeder with low-level thinking. Oh, that was good. I'm going to say that again. You cannot be a top-level feeder with low-level thinking. Why? Because the devil will make you believe you don't belong on the top. Come on. He'll make you believe you don't fit in. He'll make you believe you don't have a right to God's best. But listen, on the contrary, you and I have a right to the final things of God. Come on. We have a God-given right to have the best of God. But it is up to us, watch this, to know what God says and begin to meditate on what God says. And watch this, as we meditate, believe what he says, and then watch this, then pray what he says, and watch those things come to pass. Now, I can't help but go to my one of my very, very favorite scriptures. Turn to Joshua chapter 1. Joshua chapter 1. Look at verse number 8. Come on. If you're from down south, you call them Joshua. All right. But it's Joshua chapter 1. Look at verse number 8. Joshua chapter 1. Focus here on verse number 8 because I want you to see how God was effective in showing Joshua how to prosper and have good success as he began to meditate on the word of God. Now, Joshua 1, verse 8, look at what it says. It says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do all that is written therein, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Now, watch this now. Let me give you a definition that will work for our lesson on what this book of law is. Because sometimes you tell folks it's the law and they freak out. Listen, the book of the law is simply a book of instructions. All right? It is a book of instructions. All right? When God gave Moses the Ten Commandments, or you read the Pentateuch, it is simply instructions where there are boundaries that are set, that this is how I want you to do life. All right? From Genesis to Deuteronomy, God begins to set forth instructions because, hear me, God could not judge his people if he did not give them guidelines. Okay? God could not judge rightfully if he did not give them guidelines and instructions on, watch this, on how he wanted them to live. This is why God can judge us, because God has given us instructions on how he wants us to live. And when we go outside the scope, the boundaries that God has laid before us, now when God issues out punishment, we can't tell God he's wrong for that, because God has given us boundaries. Now listen, if you and I don't know God's boundaries, that's not God's fault. Oh, come on. Oh, I'm telling you, if we don't know God's boundaries, that's not God's fault. That's our fault. Pastor Larry, why is that? Because he's given us his word. It's been here before we got here. Our job is to read what God says to do and obey what he says to do, right? And so it's not our fault. Watch this, because the Bible says in Hosea, people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. We are destroyed because we don't know what the word of God says. We are destroyed by the enemy because we don't know, watch this now, what we have a right to. And anytime you don't know what you have a right to, anytime you don't know what the instructions are, listen, the Bible said people perish for a lack of knowledge, right? And so this book of the law is God's instructions to mankind on how to live. God has given him instructions on how we should live our lives. Now, notice here in this text the sequence in which God says to do it. The first thing God says to do, watch this now, is to familiarize yourself with God's instruction. The first thing God says to do is familiarize yourself with God's instructions. That means by keeping it before your eyes and in your mouth. All right? Become familiar with God's instructions or His word. Many of God's children don't invest the time becoming familiar with the word of God. And again, this is why we perish, for a lack of knowledge. It is not that knowledge is not there. It is because God's children, watch this, we run from knowledge. But in the book of Proverbs, you see the writer says, incline thy ear to wisdom. Incline thy heart to instruction. All through Proverbs, he tells us, when you hear instructions, listen to them. But our job is to become familiar with it. Listen, if you work for a country, if you work for an industry, the first thing they give you is a handbook. They said, become familiar, watch this, with how we do things. Become familiar with our process. Now, you may get an idea on how to make it better and upgrade. But before you do an upgrade, first become familiar with how we do what we do, right? You have folks come to your job and give you instructions on your job, and they just got there. Come on. Besides me, don't they kind of make you itch? They've been there 10 seconds, and they say, well, if that was me, I'd do it this way. For 50 years, it's been working like this. And all of a sudden, you come with your third, I'm going to leave that alone. And so with God's word, our job is to familiarize ourselves with God's instructions by keeping it, watch this, before our eyes and in our mouth. Hear me, before our eyes and in our mouth. The second thing God says to do, he says, spend time with my instructions. He says, spend time with me, watch this now, until Holy Spirit illuminates your understanding. God says, spend time with it. See, watch this. Here is what many of us do. And again, if y'all will come on, as y'all come in, please share our page. What many of us do is that we read the word, but we don't spend time with it. What we want to do is read chapters at a time. Read whole books. Come on, read the whole book or a whole chapter, 4 or 5 chapters. But you got no understanding. What good is it to read 5 chapters but leave with no understanding? You know, one of the things I always say, I would rather you read one verse and get understanding of that one verse than read 10 chapters and have no understanding, right? And so it means we must spend time in God's instructions, spend time in His word until God gives us illumination or understanding, or watch this, or gives us a revelation of what He's saying, right? Until we hear God speak through His word and cut the light on and give us a revelation of what He's saying. Listen, stay there. Spend time with it. Not just one day, the next day, and the next day, and the next day, until you hear the Holy Ghost of God inside of you give you the instruction that you need for your life. Come on. It's almost like having a picture of a bodybuilder. And you saying, yeah, that's what I want to be. I want to have biceps, triceps, have nice pecs, come on, and have an 8-pack. But you work out one time and give up. Come on. How many of y'all been there besides your pastor? Worked out one time, one day, bless God. You were sore in your legs, sore in your back, sore in your shoulders. I mean, your want to, didn't want to. And come on, you just gave up on getting in shape. Why? Because watch this, you didn't spend time. You did not invest the time in getting your body where you wanted it. And so it is when it comes to the word of God, family. Listen, we have to spend time in the word. But then the third thing I'm going to see now, number one, you must get familiarized with God's instructions. Number two, spend time in God's instructions. Number three, watch this now, and here is the kicker here. Obey God's instruction. Woo, good God Almighty. I'm going to give it to you again. You must become familiar with God's instruction. Then spend time with God's instruction. But then you must follow God's instruction. Now, here is where we get it twisted. We have been so bamboozled that we've been saved 2 weeks, and now what we want to do is tell God to follow us and not us follow him. Come on. Can you imagine that? We want to bring God in on our instructions and say, God, this is how I want you to do it. Well, listen, God is not obligated to do what you say. Come on. God has never obligated himself to do what we say whenever what we say is outside the boundaries of his word. Come on. God is not obligated to give you anything or do anything for you. Watch this. When we don't follow his instructions. Watch this. Write this down. Isaiah 1:19. Come on. Isaiah 1:19. Ask Larry. He know it. If ye be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. That was his first scripture he learned in the whole Bible. Before he learned the Lord is my shepherd, I taught him Isaiah 1:19. If you are willing and obedient, you won't get a whooping. I'm sorry. You shall eat the good of the land. That was his first scripture. Come on. Him and Roshad. Or I call him Boshad. Don't worry. That's an inside joke. But watch this. God says, if you are willing and obedient, God is not obligated to give us anything, watch this, that does not line up with his purpose for our lives. And we want to change God's mind. Hear me. You and I, we will never be able to change God's mind. Are you hearing me? You can't change God's mind because God already knows, he already knows what he's going to do. He already knows the whole landscape of our lives. His plan for our life are already set. And it is up to you and I to come in alignment with his instructions. Now, all these three things do number four. These three things lead to, watch this, prosperity and good success. The Bible says, and then thou shalt prosper. And then thou shalt have good success. But don't miss this phrase. He said, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous. Come on. We want God to do it without following his instructions. Come on, class. We want God to open up doors and make ways and do things for us, but we don't want to follow his instructions. But that's not God's plan. God says, when you follow my plan, I will open up doors. When you follow my plan, I'll make ways. When you follow my plan, I'll create rivers in the desert. But when you follow my plan, all right? Now, understand, you say, well, Pastor, I don't get God's plan. And that's not what we do in the 21st century. The Bible says, God says, your ways are not my ways. Come on. He said, neither are your thoughts my thoughts, right? And so if my ways are not God's ways and my thoughts are not God's thoughts, then it's better for me to think the God kind of thoughts than to think my thoughts. Why? Because my thoughts jack my world up. My thoughts get me in trouble. My thoughts cause me to be in lack. My thoughts cause me to turn my heart from God. So I can't trust my thoughts. Come on. Even in Philippians, it says, let this mind be in you. Come on, you know it. That is also in Christ Jesus. And so all through the Bible, God is encouraging us to follow his instructions. Now, have you noticed what the enemy has been trying to keep you from doing? Now, have you noticed that? Listen, let me give you three things the enemy has been keeping us from doing. I mean, he has been trying his best since we've been saved to keep us from doing. Watch this. Number one, he's been trying to keep us from becoming familiar with God's instruction. He's been trying to keep us from spending time with God's instructions. He's been trying to keep us from following God's instructions. And that's why we are broke. That's why we're in lack. That's why we're depressed. That's why we're distressed. That's why we're in despair. Why? Because the devil has been successful at keeping us from becoming familiar with the word of God and his instructions. He's been successful in keeping us from keeping God's word before our eyes and in our mouths. He's been successful at keeping us from spending time with God. Therefore, we don't get revelations. We don't get illumination. We don't get understanding. And because we don't understand, we perish for a lack of knowledge. Watch this. And because of what we don't know, we don't follow instructions. Therefore, we don't get results. Oh, I pray y'all got that. That's why the Church of Jesus Christ is in trouble. We want to have God, but don't want to have God's instructions. We want God's prosperity, but don't want God's plan. Come on. We want God's redemption, but don't want the Redeemer. Are you following me? And so, have you ever asked the question, why is the devil keeping us from doing these things? Come on. He is so trying to keep us from becoming familiar with God's word. He don't want you reading God's word. He does not want you making faith confessions. Why? Because if you do, he knows you get results. He does not want us spending time in God's instructions, getting revelation. Why? Because he knows that if we do, watch this, we're going to give hell a headache. Come on. He knows that if we follow God's instructions, watch this, it's going to lead to prosperity in our lives. Watch this now. And the world is going to see the hand of God on our lives. So the devil goes out of his way. Come on. Some of you all here decided to use special imps. Come on, dear God. He says, whatever you do, don't let them get it. Because if they ever get it, they're going to be they will be a terror to our kingdom. And the devil does all he can to make sure that you and I, as God's children, don't do what's necessary in the word of God to get the kind of results. So therefore, we don't get the God kind of results in our lives. Now, in Proverbs 14:12, and Proverbs 16:25. Proverbs 14:12 and Proverbs 16:25 says this. There is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Let me give you the LDS version. He says, you have a way that you think is right, but when you finish, it's going to lead to your destruction and demise. Hear me, class. I would rather trust God than trust my way of thinking. Come on. I would rather trust God than to trust what I think I know. I would rather trust the instructions of the Bible. Listen, this book has so many instructions. If you and I would simply spend time in the Word of God, it is so full of instructions and for living, for marriage, on healing, on prosperity. Listen, it is the book of life. If we would simply spend time in this book, I guarantee you it would lead you to the place, watch this, you really want to go. But listen, if we don't spend time in it, watch this, it can be in the book, be closed up, and we never benefit from what's in the book. It is almost like having a map to a treasure that's in your backyard. You have it on the dresser, but never look at the map. Come on. And now you have all this money in your backyard. It's there rotting in the ground because you refuse to pick up the map. Hear me. The Bible is your basic instructions before leaving Earth. It is our instructions on how to live right here on this planet. But if you and I don't get into this word, we can't blame God for having lack. Come on. Now, yes, we are all going to be challenged in life. That God said we will have challenges. Okay? In the book of Job, it said, a man born of a woman, days are few, and they are full of trouble. So, yes, in this life, we are going to have trouble. Right? But our job is to find out, watch this, in this word, how to get through trouble. Come on. We go to our Bible and find out how to trouble our trouble. But watch this. If I don't have God's perspective, come on. If I don't have God's view on trouble, if I don't have the mind of God on the issues of life, if I don't have the mind of God on the steps I should take whenever I'm in a crisis, if I don't have the mind of God on what to do in life, then watch this. I can be in life, and watch this. I will embrace the thought process of a fool. Come on. You will embrace a fool And the Bible said a fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Can you imagine how many folks right now are on television talking about the higher power, won't even acknowledge him as God. But watch this. Oh, it's coming a day that at that name, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord to the glory of God. Now, you were saying, Pastor, how in the world am I supposed to do all of this in the middle of a crisis? You all are a good class. You all got questions. I love my class. You all are a good class. And you're saying, Pastor, now I hear you. I know, Pastor, I hear what you're saying. But how in the world am I supposed to do all this meditating with all this stuff going on? Pastor, we on lockdown. We can't go outside. We hungry. We need toilet paper. Come on, my job shut down. Dear God, Pastor, how in the world am I supposed to do all this God stuff in the middle of this epidemic? It's pandemic, okay? Watch this. If you were simply getting God's word, what you will see is that God is good for giving out promises and guarantees to those who trust him right when things don't look like it should be happening. Come on. Oh, man, listen, if you read your Bible, God is notorious. Hear me. God is known for giving out promises and guarantees in the middle of a pandemic. Come on. Right in the middle of a crisis, God says, if you do this, then I will do that. You recall the woman who was a widow. Here it is. She was making her heart ready to die. She had a son, and she was going to bake a cake. She was gathering wood. She was going to bake her some Jiffy Mix, eat it, and die. Here comes Elijah. He said, hey, girl, look here. Here's what you're going to do. Bring me some water. And before you eat that cake, give me some first. Now, what you would have said was bad preacher. Shame on you, Reverend. You're going to eat that girl's last piece of cake? But watch this. God was trying to show her how to, watch this, put him first. How to make the things of God first. And watch this now. The promise was that if you feed me first, your meal barrel will never run out. Come on. Until God sends rain. And watch this. This girl obeyed the instruction, the guarantee. And watch this. The Bible says that God did what he did. Come on. God kept his promise. God, listen, this girl, meal barrel, did not run out. Okay. Every time she wanted to eat, she had food. Why? Because she trust God, trust the man of God, trust what he said, God said, and then God did what he said. Watch this. Noah, God told Noah, Noah, if you build me an ark, I'll save your family. I will save your family. And here it is. Noah wasn't even a carpenter. Noah did what he didn't know how to do because he followed God's instruction. And while he was instructing, he was preaching. God said it's going to rain. God said it's going to rain. And they said, come on, old fool. What is rain? But watch this. I bet you. When it started raining, come on, all those folk who called Noah a fool, they weren't calling him a fool then. Come on, I bet you when the earth started flooding, they weren't calling Noah an old fool then. And guess what? God kept his promise. After that year was up, Noah came off the boat. Guess what? Land was dry, Noah was saved. And God started the whole world all over with Noah and his family. Come on, I'm going to give you one more. You recall when Jesus told the 10 lepers who came to him to be healed? Now watch this. The Bible said, or didn't say, and he even prayed for them. He said, here's what I want you to do. Go and show yourself to the priest. And the Bible says that as they obeyed or as they went, they were healed. Now, here is my point. In each one of these illustrations I've given you, each one of them, they were in a crisis. Come on. They were in a pandemic. They had trouble in their lives. Yet in the middle of their struggle, God gave them an instruction. Pastor Larry, what are you saying? that even though we're in this season, God says, okay, God says, write this down. I have an instruction to fit your season. Come on. God says, I have an instruction to fit your season. Come on. God says, I have an instruction to fit your season. Pastor, what are you saying? When Moses, who was a backslidden prophet, a backslidden preacher, when he didn't obey God and they put his eyes out, his last request to God, after his hair grew back, he said, God, let me die with my enemies. And God strengthened him. And watch this. Not only did God strengthen him, but God killed all of his enemies. And guess what? And he allowed Samson to die. Right? Because God granted his request. In all of the scripture, God began to grant the request of those who put their trust in him. Let me ask you, how many of you all did you pray and God granted your request? How many times have you prayed, God, get me out of this, and I promise you I'll serve you? And God got you out. Come on, you said, God, if you give me this, God, if you bless me right here, God, I'll serve you. And God did it. God is saying, I had cancer. God, heal me of cancer. And I'll serve you all my days. God did it. Come on. And so God then is notorious for giving us an instruction right in the middle of a famine. Right? God knows how to give us what we need right in the middle of this season right now. And give us, watch this, give us an instruction that will far outlast the season that we're in right now. Now, here then is what I want you to see. I'll notice here in the text we read over in Joshua. That what God did was God gave them a promise and a guarantee. Watch this now. Because God knew that if he did it, God says, I will choose the right time to give you a hope and a future when your future seems to be fading. Come on. God says, I'll give you a hope and a future when your future seems to be fading. Well, that was good. I'm going to say that again. God said, I'll give you a hope and a future when your future seems to be fading. Now, I won't get into Joshua chapter 1, but watch this. This is the one thing you all I love, so love about God, that God has a plan to bring good in my life, even in a bad season. Woo! God has a plan to bring good into your life in a bad season. Somebody catch that. I said, God has a plan to bring good into your life in a bad season. I'm going to say it again. Catch that. God has a plan to bring good into your life even in a bad season. Pastor, please give me some Bible for that. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. God says, for I know the thoughts I think towards you. Wait a minute. I'm going to pause for 1 second. That's a place to shout right there. God says that he knows the thoughts he thinks towards you. Pastor Larry, what thoughts are those? He says, thoughts of peace and not of evil. Watch this now. To give you an expected end. Woo-hoo, come on. How many of you are in the chat room? You are expecting a great expectation from God. Oh, listen, I don't mean in the sweet by and by. I mean in the here, in the nasty now. God has given you out, you and I, and expect it in. Now, let me give it to you in the ICE, I'm sorry, the ICB version, all right? The ICB translation, all right? That's the International Children's Bible, all right? This going to bless your socks. Watch this. It says, I say because I know what I have planned for you, saith the Lord. I have good plans for you. I don't plan to hurt you. I plan to give you hope and a good future. Oh, did y'all hear that? God said, I have planned to give you hope and a good future. Oh, dear God. In other words, God says, I already know what I am going to do for you. Listen, y'all, the other day, I heard a quote from the late Dr. Charles Price. Hey, Dick, I wonder if it came to you, the late Dr. Joseph Charles Price. This is what he said. He said, I do not care how dark the night. I believe in the coming of the morning. That was good. He said, I do not care how dark the night. I believe in the coming of the morning. Now, I'm going to tell you where he got it from. Weeping may endure for a night. But joy, you know it. Come on, say it. Come on, come on, talk back to me. Come on, touch your neighbor and say it's coming in the morning. Have to get in there one time tonight. Well, listen, God already knows what he's going to do. And so then it is safe to say that meditation, watch this now, that meditation then will cause us to anticipate and expect what is not yet seen in the physical realm. I'm going to say that again. Meditation, what meditation does is it will cause you and I to anticipate and expect what is not yet seen in the physical realm. Ooh, somebody come on, catch that now. I said meditation will cause us to have or to anticipate and expect what is not seen in the physical realm. Which means then, I can see it in my mind when I don't possess it in my hand. Come on, I can see it in my mind when I don't possess in my hand. I can have it in my heart what I don't possess in my hand. Come on. I have it now, even though I don't possess it tangibly in my hand. Right? But it comes as I meditate. Now, the question becomes then, what then is the connection between what is in my head and what comes out of my mouth? Come on. What then is the connection between what is in my head, which means what I'm thinking, and what comes out of my mouth, which means what I'm saying? Proverbs 23, verse 7. Proverbs 23, verse 7, the A part of the verse. The A part of the verse. It says, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. As he thinketh in his heart, so is he. In other words, your heart, Bible says to guard your heart, for out of it are the issues of life. Many of us, you all, we just put our hearts in anybody's hand. Oh, dear God, we embrace all kind of crazy doctrine. And we embrace it because we think it's new in revelation. Listen, the Bible says, God says there is no private interpretation of scripture. We may say it differently, but it should get us back to the same point. Come on. Because when we interpret scripture, listen, scripture interprets itself, right? And so God says, as we think in our heart, that's what we're going to do. Come on, Proverbs chapter 6, verse 2, the A part of the verse says, we are snared with the words of our mouth, which suggests then that I will say what I think. Come on. How many of you all have a tendency to say what you think? Come on. It's like, it's almost like cussing by accident. Come on. Well, Pastor, you know, Pastor, that just slipped. No, it didn't slip. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Whatever in your heart in abundance will come out of your mouth. All right? Whatever in our hearts in abundance will come out of our mouth. If you think fear, doubt, and unbelief, that's what's going to come out of your mouth. If you think you'll never get healed, that's what comes out of your mouth. If you think you're never going to make it and get through it, that's what's going to come out of our mouth. What flows in our heart in abundance is what we say out of our mouths. I can tell how you believe by what you say. Come on. You can say oops all you want to. You can say, Pastor, I didn't mean to say that. No. That's what you hold in your heart in abundance. Not based on what Pastor Larry says, based on the word of God. Come on. What you hold in your heart in abundance. See, watch this. I'll prove it to you. Peter told Jesus, wherever you go, I'll go. He was the same guy who said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." Same dude. But when Jesus was on his way to the cross, and they asked Peter, "Are you the follower of Christ?" Peter said, "Heck no." Come on. Peter, watch this. He was more concerned with his own life, come on, than giving up his life for Jesus Christ. He said it with his mouth, but then in his heart, that's not how he really felt. Come on. Because what came out of his mouth is how he really felt. Now, yes, Peter finally got it right. Come on, thank God. He preached the gospel and 3,000 souls were saved. So Peter got it right. But watch this. It is what's in our heart in abundance. The Bible says we believe, therefore we speak. Right? And so we will confess or say what we believe. Now watch this. Many of us, we start out confessing. We start out saying the right things. But watch this question. What do we do when what we see does not begin to line up with what we say? Come on. What do we do with our confession? What do we do with our spiritual intake when what we see does not line up with our confession or how we believe? Come on now. Because watch this. The Bible says you did run well. Who hindered you? Come on. You started off pretty good. Come on. You had a zeal, but not the power. Come on. So what do we do when life throws us moments of contradiction? Come on. Where it does not line up with our expectation. When life does not line up with what we think or believe how things were going to turn out. Come on. Have you ever thought God would do things one way and God didn't do it? Have you ever looked for provision one in one area and God said, nope, they ain't the one? Come on, we've all been there. Listen, don't feel bad. We have all been there. But God has a plan. Hear me. God has a plan to get us to where we want to go. All right? Ready for it? All right. I give it to you tomorrow. I'll pick up tomorrow right there. On tomorrow, we're going to look into God's plan. That as we meditate in God's word, God, watch this, God will give us a plan right in the middle of a pandemic. Woo, come on. God will give us a plan in the middle of a pandemic. I'm going to say that again. God will give us a plan in the middle of a pandemic. Tomorrow, I'm going to show you a plan that God gave in the middle of a crisis situation. And then watch this. If you keep on reading the chapter, that plan worked because they did what God said to do. And I'm going to show you and prove it to you based on the word of God that as we follow instructions, God will give us starting grace and give us finishing grace. But watch this. We're the ones who must begin to follow and obey his instructions. Come on. But y'all blessed tonight. Woo. Glory to God. Man. I pray y'all were blessed tonight by the word. Let's pray. Father, tonight, thank you so much for your word. We pray, God, for those who are on our prayer board. God, thank you that today we added 30 more names to our prayer board. And God, we pray, God, and thank you in advance that lives are being changed and rearranged as a result of your word. Thank you, Father, that faith is coming alive in our hearts. Thank you, God, that bodies are being healed, minds are being renewed and transformed as a result of your word. Now we send your word to every name on this board. God, your word of healing, your word of deliverance, your word of power. God, cause change tonight. Thank you in advance that lives are being changed and transformed in the name of Jesus. I believe it's done by faith in the finished works of Jesus. I thank you. It is so. Amen, amen, and amen. Listen, tonight, if you're not saved, if you are not saved, hear me. Tonight, if you don't know Jesus as your Savior, I challenge you tonight. Make him your Savior. Pastor Larry Howe, by repeating this after me, come on, say, "Dear Jesus, come into my life. I need you. Save me from all of my sins. I acknowledge my transgression. I accept your finished work of Calvary. In the name of Jesus, forgive me now of all of my sins. I receive you as Lord of my life. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. Listen, if you pray that prayer, the Bible says that your name right now has just been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And all of heaven is rejoicing because of a decision you made tonight to make Jesus your Lord. Listen, everybody in the room, let's give God a big praise for our newfound family in Christ Jesus. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. All right, y'all, it's time to go. Are y'all blessed tonight? I pray you were. Come on. Time for a hug. Let's go. Let's get it. Gary, for you, baby. Everybody else, come on. Big hugs. Come on, y'all. Make some noise with it. Come on. Big group hug. Let's go. Come on. Show some love. Show some love. Show some love. Show some love. Glory to God. Come on. Amen. Pastor Larry loves you all. Hey, Brother Colin, I see you. Hey, Mike. Brother Lillian, bless you, dear. Reverend Price, I see you. T-Baby. All right, I see you, Gary. All right, all right. Woo! Y'all blessed tonight by the word. I pray you were. All right, Mr. Karen. Mr. Price. You know, that's it. Make some noise. Sister Yvette. Sister Barbara Jean Robinson. Amen. Don't forget CI Cash App. Gina. Sending big hugs. All right. Sister Tracy. Send CI Cash App. If you want to send your offerings this week, see a Cash App. Send it there. I believe and I know God will bless your life for the better. Carmella. Netta Deer. Great big hugs. Love y'all family to life. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, declare family, today will be the what? Best day of your life. Come on, declare it. Woo! Glory to God. Listen, you don't want to miss tomorrow. All right? Don't forget, on Friday at 11 o'clock, we will be in our Sunday school. All right? Call into our prayer conference number. All right? And be a part of our Sunday school time. If you don't want to talk, chime in. And just put your phone on mute and listen. All right? Hey, Mother Curry. I see you, girl. Good night. Bless y'all. Listen, I pray sweet rest tonight. Oh, y'all, somebody's singing right there. Who is that? I see you, Reverend. Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you, Barbara. 11 o'clock. At 11 o'clock a.m. Central Standard Time. Tomorrow at 11 o'clock Central Standard Time. The Sunday school time will be on. Again, if you don't want to talk, you can mute your phone and listen in. All right? It's going to be good. Oh, bless your heart. You working? Child, me too. Oh, my Lord. All right. Come on, Cliff, confess it. That's right. Sweet rest. Amen, amen. All right, y'all, as we always say, we who have the God kind of faith, we call those things which are not as though they were. And our trust is in God because we stay in faith. And stay focused because God has you and I in the palm of his hand. All right? We love you so much. Lord bless you all so much. See you tomorrow night right here at 6:55 p.m. Central Standard Time. All right? Central Standard Time. Listen, I encourage you to call somebody. Tell them to tune in. All right? Listen, you don't want to miss tomorrow night. It's going to bless your life for the better. All right, y'all, gotta go. God bless you. Love y'all.